As you probably know from a previous episode, I am going to be running the LA Marathon in a few weeks. Actually, it's Sunday, March 8th, 2020. So you probably won't be surprised to hear I have become extremely obsessed with everything about running right now. It's constantly on my mind, and if you were to check my YouTube search history, you're going to find a lot of running-related searches, a lot of world championship and Olympic-level running stuff that I've been watching. About 1 month ago, I couldn't tell you anything that was going on in the world of competitive running, but over the last 6 weeks or so, I've probably watched 3 full marathons and pretty much every world championship race in the 5,000 to 10,000 meters over the last 4 years or so. And I found out something really interesting. Are you familiar with the name Eliud Kipchoge? He is the current world record holder in the marathon with a time of 2 hours, 1 minute, and 39 seconds, which is about 4 minutes and 38 seconds per mile. I think it's probably one of the most incredible human performances of all time, especially when you consider the marathon is very, very grueling. And if you can do that in a mile, in my opinion, you're an awesome runner. So it's pretty remarkable. Plus, he obliterated the previous world record, so much so that most people in the running community thought that this world record would stay for years, if not decades, unless he himself, Eliud, broke it. Now, another reason that you may be familiar with Eliud is that he is also the runner who worked on the Breaking 2 project, which is a Nike event that they basically created a race just for him. They didn't follow all the rules of a typical marathon. Like, they allowed him to have different pacers that cycled in and out throughout the race. He could take additional fluids at different times and they could be actually handed to him, things like that. But at the end of the day, he, a human being, ran 26.2 miles in 1 hour and 59 minutes and 40 seconds, which was the whole point of the quote Breaking 2 thing. Now, the reason I think this is interesting is that there are probably a lot of listeners that have heard the name Eliud Kipchoge. I mean, he's kind of famous. He has a million followers on Instagram. But what I think is interesting about this is unless you're really deep in the running scene, like I now am, apparently, you probably have not heard the name Kenenisa Bekele. Now, if you stack Kenenisa's record up with Eliud's, their running credentials are very similar. Bekele is the current world record holder in the 5,000 and the 10,000 meters. He's done just about everything you can do as a runner. He has 3 Olympic gold medals and 5 world championships, where Eliud has 1 gold medal and 1 world championship. But here's the thing. A few months ago, Bekele ran a marathon in Berlin where he came within 2 seconds of beating this world record that Eliud set. Again, this is something that the running community basically thought would never happen unless Eliud himself broke his own record. Here's part of my point. If Bekele had run 2 seconds faster, do you really think that the amount of celebrity around Eliud would have been mitigated compared to him? Like, just to put this in perspective, Eliud has, like I said, 1 million followers on Instagram. Bekele has about 63,000. That delta is not because he didn't run 2 seconds faster. I mean, he's currently the world record holder in 2 other events. Now, granted, a lot of those followers might have been brought on to a certain extent from Nike's Breaking 2 campaign that I mentioned earlier, where they created a whole campaign around him. They built a shoe for him. They put him on advertising, television, stuff like that. But the question is, why did Nike decide to go with Eliud instead of Bekele? There's a lot of answers for that. But I don't think the argument can be it's the difference of how credentialed they are as runners. I think that Eliud has just dedicated much more time to branding himself. He uses social media much better, or he's hired someone to do it for him. He seems to use all the tools in front of him and has really capitalized on the benefits that social media and branding can bring to someone like himself, an athlete or an entrepreneur. He's constantly giving interviews. He's constantly in front of the camera, just creating a lot of buzz around himself. And there's a lot to learn from this. In today's day and age, it's important to recognize that it's not just about who can do something the best. It's about utilizing the tools that everyone has access to and then leveraging your natural strengths as best as possible to build your brand, regardless of what profession that you're in. Now, if you frequently listen to this podcast as a side hustle, or you're a full-time real estate entrepreneur, or just an entrepreneur in general, just ensure that you're not getting caught up being hyper-focused on the operations side of the business and leaving money on the table by not focusing on the branding component. And especially when it comes to the social media stuff, Facebook, Instagram, LinkedIn, these tools are all there and they're basically free. I would pick two and go all in on those. It depends on who your clients are. Depends on which one allows you to speak in your voice best. You know, Twitter, for example, I don't use a lot, but it may be the one for you and your clients. You know, we've had a lot of success on LinkedIn. I don't drive it myself. I do check the comments and the messages every now and then, but for the most part, I have a team member run my whole account. You know, sending out friend requests, accepting friend requests, sending messages, directing people to check out other private Facebook groups that we run, which also are not run by me. You know, they handle a lot of the engagement. And so because of that, I am much more visible. The point is, there's a lot to this more than meets the eye. It's not just about who can run the marathon the fastest. You know, the question is, like I said, you think if Bekele ran 2 seconds faster, that would make up the difference? No, it's not about that at all. You know, here's another way of thinking about this when it comes to real estate. I saw recently that Grant Cardone raised $100 million very, very quickly. He's probably going to purchase another $300 million worth of real estate in 2020, something like that, or more. Now, the question is, do you really think that Grant Cardone is the best real estate investor out there? Do you really think that he has the best acquisition team or the best management team? Is that actually what's the difference between him and his competitors? Probably not. You know, I've interviewed him and he's a smart guy. I actually think that he is a deep thinker and doesn't really get the credit he deserves when it comes to a lot of his philosophy, because a lot of people view him through a particular lens, which I totally understand. You can actually listen to our interview. You can't hear it, but in reality, he gave me the middle finger during the interview. He was playing around, but still, I mean, that's kind of the attitude. That's kind of his atmosphere that he wants people to see him as, but he understands this game at a very, very high level. I mean, he is in pursuit of being a billionaire, and that is not out of the question. But the reason that he's in that pursuit and the reason that it's not out of the question is that he has two incredible tools. He has the branding, he has the marketing component, which is on lock, a lot of which he generated himself for free by the use of these social media platforms. And then he has a very lucrative outlet for that branding, which is real estate. Now, if you're listening to this, you know what the tools are. It took him actually longer to figure it out than I think it should have. But now he figures it out, and now all of a sudden they have more than $1 billion under management. So don't let this opportunity pass you by. Find the tools that work best for you. Find the tools that your client base is already using. Take action to the best of your ability. Leverage your natural strengths. And by the way, if you don't want to do it, hire someone to do it for you. All right, listeners, you know the routine. This show is all about learning, making wise investments, and protecting and growing your capital. So if you're interested in these topics, make sure to hit the subscribe button. Of course, if you've already enjoyed a couple of great episodes, don't be shy. Leave a review. It really helps the show's visibility. And lastly, if you're an accredited investor and you're interested in learning more about our investment opportunities, the types of deals that I personally invest in, go to asymcapital.com. That's asymcapital.com. Thanks a lot.